I didn't have a PowerPoint, and given some of the folks who had my PowerPoint, it's the first time, I think, in years I'm going to speak without one, so this goes well. And I was asked by Ingrid and Greg for inviting me to a conference today to speak about India and China. So that's an impossible task, although I think everyone who spoke before me and after me has maybe in some ways even harder task in terms of at least the number of countries in this conference. So I thought what I would do is basically make two broad areas of remarks. One is standard contrasts between India and China. I'm going to mention three, and then some common challenges despite these sort of standard contrasts. So let me start with the sort of first set. I'll try to keep it to 15 minutes because I know probably a lot of things to discuss. So the first standard contrast we read about, and it has a very powerful material reality, of course, is that China is the shop floor of the world. A very dramatic structural transformation in its economy since the late 1970s and global integration through rapid industrialization. So that many of the things that are in this room right now probably have been made in China labeled on them, even if we take into account the complications of global supply chain. India, on the other hand, quite strikingly, has not had the type of industrialization that many other countries had. So it's industrialized, of course. Right? Even under the Nehruvian period in the 50s and 60s, its industrial base expanded and diversified prior to the, compared to the colonial regime. And since the 80s, and particularly since the 90s when liberalization first began, we see a diversification of the industrial sector and the corporate class, so that there are certain conglomerates that have grown and even become sort of global players. You could think of something like the Tata Company, which, you know, a few years ago bought Jaguar, sort of marquee label in Britain. Now it's trying to get rid of the steel plant it has in Port Talbot. You may have been reading about in the papers in the last couple of weeks. So there are Indian companies that have become global players, but nothing quite to the same extent as China. And certainly if you look at measures, if I had slides I have had in previous presentations about global integration in terms of export and imports and how much Chinese demand is driving imports and exports in different countries, you'd see quite a different picture. One of the things that's very striking is since the late 1970s, if you were to plot the role or the size of the manufacturing sector in total Indian GDP, it's roughly constant. It's quite striking. So what you see happening over the last 30, 40 years, is that the value added by agriculture in India has declined. But it still has over 50% of the workforce, but only contributes maybe 20% of GDP. And the service sector is what has been the inverse. Right? The service sector as a percentage of GDP has grown inversely to agriculture's decline, but it employs, certainly in the formal sector, very few. So the one that we know of, for instance, is IT. So China is the shop floor of the world. India we often call the back office of the world, or the pharmacy of the global south. What's interesting is this is all in IT, biotech, and so on. It's very high-end value-added production, but it employs very few people. It's the entire IT sector in India, population 1.2 billion, of course the labor force is smaller, employs maybe 3 to 5 million. It depends on how you count people work. It's tiny. Of course, we could say that many of these engineers are now in Silicon Valley, running all the companies of the United States. But still, it just tells you something about that. So that structural transformation, which has happened in the most dramatic way historically in China in terms of its rapidity, has not happened in India. And I think that helps explain the challenges that both countries face today, which are quite different. So again, we read every day in the papers that China is trying to shift from an export investment-led model of growth, particularly in construction, of real estate and infrastructure and heavy industry, towards more consumption-led, domestic-driven growth model. There's a lot of financial repression in China as well through the state banks that are directing heavily subsidized credit to state-owned enterprises. And in India, they've been struggling for a long time to expand industrialization, most acutely with the new Prime Minister, Narendra Modi, who's come to power. And if you just read the slogans in the papers, this government, in the last 2 years, as championing Make in India, Digital India, Smart Cities, just underlines the fact that even though we've had urbanization and Indian industrialization, it's nothing like the Chinese model. And so these challenges are quite different because of these underlying realities that present. There's a sort of divergence. The second contrast, which was very striking today and that has big implications, is demographic. In this sense, India is very much like the MENA era. India is set today to have a demographic dividend. A very large percentage of its population is young. And that is what is meant to help fuel its growth. But of course, that depends on how well trained this labor force is. And it very much depends on what kinds of jobs are available to it. The formal economic, the formal organized sector in India employs less than 10% of its labor force. The private organized sector employs roughly 2%. Lots of neoclassical economists, there's a very big controversial debate on this, of course, ask the question, why is that the case? And many of them blame labor laws, right? Too many regulations. But that's not an easy answer as well, because many Indian companies, for instance, have very small organized workforces that are far below the limit at which labor laws kick in. So Vincent Punabharathan, the Indian economist, has said, if these labor laws really meant something, then we should expect many companies to hire, say, up to 95 workers in their units, because at 100 workers, those labor laws kick in, but the average size is about 12. So something else is going on, and that's a lack of infrastructure and connectivity and so on. So we have this demographic dividend of India, but very much like the MENA region, I've used some comparisons here, there has been a lack of training and investment in that, and job training skills, and expansion of gainful employment. And I think that's one of the reasons, again, we have seen repeated outbursts in India over jobs, right? And one incidence of this is quite peculiar phenomenon of relatively high caste youth in the state of Gujarat, for instance. This is the western most industrialized state in India, where Narendra Modi is from, and many of India's most fabled capitalists are from, demanding quotas for government jobs, which are meant for traditionally backward castes. Now, why would that be the case? It would be the case because they cannot find employment in this economy, which is growing very fast. India is the second fastest growing country, big country in the world over these last 4 years, only behind China. China, on the other hand, is at the so-called Lewis turning point. It now is facing a demographic deficit. For the first time since 2012, the size of its labor force has not grown. Now that's had some good effects, which is that as the labor supply has shrunk, there's been a tightening of the labor market. We see this particularly in the Pearl River Delta, right? So there's sort of very much two Chinas. So it's the old Rust Belt China in the northeast, and then the sort of new manufacturing bases in the south in the Pearl River Delta. In the southern region, we have seen growing labor militancy, wildcat strikes, attempts to organize. Independent trade unions are disallowed in China, but that's one of the major issues that the movement is trying to push. We've seen real wages actually rise quite consistently in the last decade, from most of the data we have. And so many labor activists that I've actually interviewed in Hong Kong and that region have said they can see this now as a real important turning point. And of course, the causes of this tend to be twofold. One is the One China, One Child policy itself, which the government now has realized has caused an acute demographic crisis and is trying to relax. But many families are saying through these surveys that they've been conducting that maybe a quarter of these families might have a second child anyway, simply because they afford to have a second child in this economy that China has become. And part of it has to do simply rising prosperity. The growing power of women in households, which we know historically in most countries leads to a decline of the total fertility rate. So in China, you begin to see the sort of growing power of labor, growing your wages, so therefore the ratio that's going to profits and investment might come back towards labor into households. But we also see, because we know this is a phase of late capitalist development, maybe we call it at this stage, I don't know how many lates we need, a growing automation of industrial production. And that's also happening in India, it's very striking. A lot of foreign investors that are investing in India, because they're trying to take advantage of relatively, people say they're trying to take advantage of relatively cheaper labor in India vis-a-vis China, now that Chinese labor has become more expensive. Actually, you see growing automation of industrial processes. It's not clear what impact that's going to have. And the third big contrast is, you could say, the size of the, it's a set of things. It has to do with prosperity and reduction in poverty in both countries. So China's middle classes have grown. Again, very much depends on what definition and measures we use. I'm going to refer to Sanjay Reddy's most recent project, the Global Income Consumption Project. I have the data to show it to you, but the size of the Chinese middle class has really grown, using different measures. The Indian middle classes have grown too, but not nearly to the same extent. That has partly to do with this nature of growth that I've just talked about. We know that the decline in absolute poverty in China has been quite phenomenal. If you use a low measure of $1 a day, $1.25 a day, maybe $2 a day, but as you move up, of course, that ratio, the steepness of the curve, right, really flattened out. So there are different measures that we can use. The downward trend seems to be fairly consistent across measures, but again, the story is a study of contrast. India, I'll mention two figures I do know off the top of my head. In the early 1970s, the official poverty rate by government figures is roughly 45%. It's a very mean, harsh measure, right, of a consumption basket. By 2005, it's roughly 23%. If you simply use World Bank figures for that same period, at $2 a day, this is a revised estimate, 2008, the poverty rate drops, this is our sort of $2 a day, from 75% of the population to 65%. And those are two different worlds, depending on which poverty measure we use. And if you use higher ones, you see something different. And the other area, of course, you see it is the long-term path-dependent effects of investments in health and education. India has really struggled in this realm compared to China. There was a lot of turmoil during the Maoist period, as we know. And certainly, the immense social cost of the Great Leap Forward and the Cultural Revolution, many scholars have talked about. But the investments in health and education, public health, primary education, were very difficult. And it has led to that sort of scaling of the workforce, which could take advantage of these manufacturing opportunities as China began to move in that direction in the 1980s. India today is still trying to catch up. It finally has universal literacy at the primary level, but the health sector, which is one that I've been studying recently, although it has improved, is still in, you know, it's still in a sort of acute crisis, particularly in the rural sector. So these are those basic studies of contrast. Now, what are the common challenges? I'll try to finish on this. So one is that despite these very different trajectories of growth and development and transformation, you see, of course, many social conflicts in India and China over these years. Now, these, of course, preceded liberalization. I don't think it's a very simple one-to-one causal relation. But we do see, of course, growing social conflicts in both countries. In China, in the 1990s, we have data on so-called mass incidents. The Public Security Bureau began to collect. They rose from about 10, and these are very rough group figures, roughly 10,000 a year in the early 1990s to about over 120,000, just over a decade later, at which point they stopped collecting them. So we don't have figures post-2005, actually. In India, we know, we see a lot of these social conflicts over land, over labor, over dispossession of various kinds. And we even see, of course, a Maoist movement that reemerges post-2004. A lot of Chinese liberals that I meet can't quite believe that the Maoist movement is strong in India. When they're trying to, they said, these are the liberals in China, overcome the legacy of the Mao in China. But you have this this Maoist movement in the central, in central India, in the tribal hinterlands, which the state has been very aggressively and viciously trying to repress. So these growing social conflicts are there, and one of the outcomes of that, very strikingly, is around 2003-04, you had two new regimes coming to India and China, Hu Jintao, Wen Jiabao. China and the Manmohan Singh, Sonia Gandhi, Congress Party led UPA in India. And in both cases, they rolled out these new welfare regimes, quite important welfare regimes. In China's case, you might say it was a sort of a recovery of welfare. The recovery of the welfare that the Maoist regime had put in place, but then had been dismantled under Deng Xiaoping's reforms in the 1980s. So for instance, the most acute example would be rural healthcare. We're all familiar with the barefoot doctors of the Cultural Revolution in the 1960s. The rural healthcare probably covered 95% of rural China in the early 1980s to the brigades. By the late 1990s, coverage was around 10%. And so post 2004-5, in the Hu-Wen regime, there's been an expansion of rural cooperative healthcare. And you see that in a number of areas, and in India as well. So this, a lot of scholars have used a sort of Polanyian heuristic, the great transformation of the double movement. This is the way it's been working out in India and China as well. And so that's a sort of commonality. So even though China's growing faster, even though poverty's declining more quickly, you still see real patterns of dispossession, which are causing governments to have to respond to demands and conflicts and protests for basic social entitlements and economic protection. The second area, which I think is really intriguing, because you wouldn't expect it, because these are two contrasting regimes, right? A party-led state and the world's largest representative democracy, with a bewildering number of parties contesting for power. In both places, you see this growing nexus of corruption and inequality. In China, of course, it is in the party itself, right? So in the late 1990s, the party decided to change its doctrine to also incorporate capitalists. It's called the three represents. Right? So capitalists are now part of the party. But in both places, whether you have, the 450 parties contesting for power in the last Indian election, or the one party in China, well, I think there's seven or eight, but only one, of course, really makes it to the. Only one has power. In both places, right, the number of oligarchs within the party, who either using their wealth in order to capture political power or using political power in order to expand their wealth, is something quite striking. So these are very different regimes, very different party structures. And yet we see this. And one of the interesting things then that's common as well, which really surprised me when I began to notice it, is that despite these very different regimes and very different legacies, right, Maoism versus Gandhianism, Peruvianism, however you want to describe it, is in both places we see very powerful rights-based movements emerge in the last 25 years. And these rights-based movements are increasingly using the courts and law and the language of constitutionalism to demand greater political transparency and greater social entitlements. Now, the genealogy of these rights are different. In some cases, they're simply liberal constitutionalist rights. Right? So the rights activists we read about a lot in particularly the Western press are these sort of liberal constitutionalist activists. But you see, for instance, many workers from the old Rust Belt in China, where they're demanding their rights, are using different types of tropes, Maoist, Confucian. Many of the rights activists in India are actually influenced by very sort of Gandhian socialist ideas. Right? So it's sort of a very interesting sort of development you see. You do see a disjuncture, whereas in India, the rights movement has very closely shaped the new welfare regime. So that many of the new laws we see are the right to information, the right to education, the right to rehabilitation for land acquisition, and so on and so forth. Right? The demand for transparency, the demand for rights has become coterminous with the demand for greater social entitlements. In China, in the same period, we see the state very much try to break this convergence. So in China, it's very interesting. And since 2004, there's been a rapid expansion of new welfare programs, but there's been a severe clampdown on the judiciary and on the NGO sector and on rights-based activists under the sort of doctrine of stability maintenance. The most famous example, probably, in fact, he was a fellow here at the New School a few years ago, Xu Jiong, an activist, a lawyer who set up the Open Constitution Initiative, which was demanding the transparency to see the incomes of government officials and so on and so forth. So that's a sort of interesting sort of convergence, divergence, depends on how you look at it. And the last one, I'll end with this, because I know I've probably got a minute left, and it's sort of the biggest one. So Marjan asked me, said, we should think about what do we mean by development. So this, of course, whatever metaphor you want to use, the elephant in the room or the critical or public question we face is climate change. So how do India and China either continue this industrialization? In India's case, it wants to pursue industrialization. In China's case, it wants to pursue a sort of higher level industrialization to avoid the middle income trap. How do they do that when they face acute crises of pollution and ecological damage? Delhi and Beijing have a very infamous competition of being one of the most polluted cities in the world. You've either been to both, you can testify to this. Water pollution, particularly in the riparian sector. Increasing water stress, right, which partly has to do with the nature of irrigation, certainly in India, but is being exacerbated by global warming. India right now has had two successive years of a drought, and there's an acute water crisis in a third of its states. And this is a real flashpoint, not simply within these countries, but between these countries, because a large percentage of their fresh waters are commonly sourced in the Himalayan basin, which I read estimate 30 to 40% of the water for this part of Asia is dependent on that region. So this is something we have to really see. So that sort of leads to sort of three broad questions, sort of options, you might say. One is, given these challenges, you know, do India and China try to pursue a new form of dependent development? China, of course, as we said from the very first presentation, right, might be a new motor in sort of relations of dependency in the world system, which has, of course, evolved and changed in really important ways. In ways, actually, when you think about historically, it would be hard to imagine in the 1970s. Right? So I think we need to read history to sort of surprise ourselves a little bit to see what people were writing then, whether they could have foreseen a world that looks like the one that we have today. The second one, which a lot of, in India certainly, lots of the conservation movement, which is very influenced by sort of Gandhian tropes, is can you pursue development without industrialization? So Gandhi very famously said that if India tried to industrialize like Britain, it would strip the world like locusts. And there's a very powerful, but of course it's still a marginal lobby, but I think it's growing in India, asking these questions sort of anew. They've been asked right from the anti-colonial movement. And the third is, if India and China continue to industrialize, and so we saw these flashpoints take place in Paris just recently about global responsibility and historical justice, who should bear the cost of climate change? China's roughly 25% of global emissions now, India's probably 7 to 8%, but in per capita terms, they're much less. India's probably a tenth of the United States. China's probably a quarter. Can you have what many economists sort of call a low carbon transition? Can you continue to industrialize with carbon intensity and ag and you know sort of absolute carbon output emissions decline? So I think those are sort of three sort of broad scenarios that are being sort of debated, discussed in both these countries and of course in other countries. So it's also ended there.
For me, it's a privilege to be in a new school, a non-traditional school. I believe, especially nowadays, where we live, living a let's say a right-wing group rising, especially in Latin America, but I believe in other parts of the world. You see in Europe, right-wing rising. Maybe in the U.S., we see Trump movement. I think non-traditional spaces like this, it's very important because we know what the new classical economists will have as policy recommendations for me. It's a privilege to be here to talk about Latin America. I come from Brazil, I come from this region. Even though I'm serving for the Brazilian constituency at the IDB, the Inter-American Development Bank, I won't speak on behalf of the IDB, I won't speak on behalf of the Brazilian government. Whatever I say here, whatever stupid or smart I say here, it's on my own behalf. My plan to, well, I want to talk about three main issues with you here today. First, I'll talk about the concept of development. I believe what I believe is the most important theoretical contribution from Latin America, which is the CEPAL, or the English acronym ECLAC, the Economic Commission for Latin America and the Caribbean. I want to talk very briefly about what I believe is the main contribution from this heterodox perspective, from this heterodox way of looking at development. The second topic I want to talk about is about the heterogeneity in Latin America. It's really hard to talk on the region as a whole, as a homogeneous block. And particularly looking at productive structures and demand structures. And at last, I want to talk about what was the main accomplishments of the last 15 years. In the case of Latin America, together with the commodity boom, we also had what is the so-called pink tide, or in Spanish, the marea rosa, which means that after the neoliberalism crisis in the 90s, many left-wing governments were elected in the region. So together with the commodity cycle, we also had several left-wing governments in power. And I want to talk a little bit about what are the accomplishments of this period and what are the challenges for the future, for the post-commodity boom. So that means that I won't talk about Brazil. I saw that the professor was commenting a little bit about Brazil. I believe my country today faces one of its most difficult times for our generation. And I'm happy to talk about that on the Q&A session if there's interest on that. Because in my opinion, after the right wing has been losing elections for so many times, they are now willing to take power against the constitution. Okay, so let's go back to the presentation. Okay, what are the main, as I say, the Latin American, it's also known about as the Latin American structuralism. I believe most of you know what is the CEPAL contribution, and if you don't know, I believe you'll be interested on learning more about it, since you're looking for heterodox perspective for development. That's why I put it here. I'll be very brief. There are many aspects about it. So I'll try to mention what can be the basis of it. The main professors that founded the CEPAL in the late 50s, it was, I would mention Raoul Pervish and Celso Furtado, these two main professors among others. And they were convinced that the new classical approach was not enough to discuss development in Latin America at this time. And they were also convinced that Keynesianism was not enough for Latin America. And Raoul Pervish once answered, when they asked him, are you guys in CEPAL, are you guys Keynesians? And he answered, well, in order to be Keynesian, I first need to be structuralist. And that's why, from his point of view, Keynesianism was making a critical review of the new classical economies and trying to make recommendations on how to reach a higher level of employment through monetary policy and fiscal policy and so on. And for them, they'll say, okay, in Latin America, since we have we do not have the same structure of capital as a country like the UK or the US or a developed country. First, we need to establish capital stock. We have to establish a capital structure, so then we can be Keynesians. That's their perspective on how to deal with Keynesianism. So it's, I would say, something complementary to that. It's in addition to it. But let's say Latin America is a step away from doing Keynesian policy as they were discussing in developed world in that time. As an example, why he would answer that is that if there is a world shock like we live now in an underdeveloped world, if you do monetary policy or fiscal policy, if you can somehow using economic policy to keep your economic your activity level high, that means you would keep your imports level high, but your export would go down, so you would suffer from foreign constraints. So that's why he says, in order to be Keynesian, at first, they need to be structuralist. What are the main theoretical aspects? First is that history matters. And here is that we cannot look at economies in Latin America, or any economy, I would say, as a productive function. The idea is that if your country was inserted into the world economy to produce sugarcane, and it was established a plantation with produce sugar, and you had slavery and you had big property, these will impact your economy from a sociological perspective, anthropological perspective, political perspective, and these will impact your economy through time. And there's also the idea that the way these economies were inserted into the world economies, it was basically to support the industrialization process that were happening in the core economies or center economies. So if they were needing raw materials, if they were needing oil, if they were needing sugar or whatever, so that's how these economies first met capitalism. It was through the process of development of the core economy, and they were established to support this process. And why does history matters in the end is that they could make the critics to the idea that development happens through stages, the known Rostov approach. So one cannot say that Brazil is underdeveloped because we are in a lower level of development, and with time we're going to get there. We're going to go through the productive function, and with time we're going to accumulate capital, we're going to have a higher income level, and then we're going to get there. So the idea is that since, because of the way you participate in the world economy, because what you produce to the world economy, your condition of peripheral or your condition of underdeveloped, it can reproduce. The vulnerabilities of the way, of the role you play in the world economy will not naturally be overcome with time, or with, if you allow commodity to flow, if you allow capital to flow, the market will allow you to accumulate capital and to improve, and to get there, to get to the stages of development. So here, another approach they have is the center-periphery dynamic, and that's the idea that I've been mentioning briefly, that and I agree with critics that the decoupling did not happen, and from the 50s they had also this idea that the dynamics from demand perspective and also from a tactical approach perspective would come from core economies, and the periphery would be vulnerable to that. I would also highlight the idea of structural heterogeneity, and that's basically the idea that because of the way these economies were inserted to the world economy, these economies, they live on the same country, on the same economy, they live with different types of productive levels. You have very modern sectors living with very, how can I say, low productivity sectors. You will have a huge exporter, highly productive firms living with subsistence or living with very low productivity sectors. And that, of course, impacts the labor market. The second issue I want to mention is about the about regional diversity or the heterogeneity of Latin America. And here, since they asked me to talk about Latin America, for me it's really hard to say, okay, let's talk about the challenges of the region as a whole. Also during the commodity boom, I'm going to show you, since the region is very different from a productive perspective and also from a demand perspective, it's really hard to say there's one impact during the commodity boom and there's one challenge. So I will try to organize briefly what are the main differences of the region. I could say there is one Latin America that we could divide from Panama up, which are economies that are deeply integrated to the US, which are economies that are mostly using the type of assembly industry, the so-called maquiladoras, low labor intensity industries, and the southern economies, which are mainly commodity exporters, some of them with big domestic markets, some of them with not that big domestic markets. So that's the type of differentiation we can have. So depending on what you produce, if you're an exporter of mining, if you're exporting of hydrocarbons, agriculture, and also depending if you have a relevant domestic market. This will affect your capacity to do economic policy, it will affect your capacity to do industrial policy, and this also helps explaining why a country like Brazil, even though being a great exporter of commodity, commodities could industrialize itself significantly. And today, Brazil has still, it has been struggled from the, since the 80s, but the country has allowed to build a relatively complex industrial productive structure. So I will try to show basically some different types of countries. So this, in the southern countries, we could look at countries that are exporters of hydrocarbons, countries that are mining exporters, and I will show Mercosur. And that's a graph for 2014. I believe most of you are familiar with the Atlas of Economic Complexity. And here is the idea that the more diversified or the more complex is your economy, the more developed you are. And in here, we can say that the type of insertion of the, or the type of export sets that these economies have, it's basically raw materials. Here, looking at the case of Colombia, and we can see that they're heavily weighted on oil and coal. Similar approach happens to mining exporters. And here, the case of Chile, as an example, it's heavily weighted on copper. And that's, again, is a figure for 2014. And that's the case of Mercosur. I'm using the example of Brazil, which, as you can see, has developed a more complex industry, but still, iron and soy heavily weighting on what we were exporting in 2014. And now looking to the northern part of Latin America, I have picked Honduras as an example for Central America, and they are very heavily weighted on textile industry, which is an industry with low labor intensity, and then the case of Mexico, which is another economy from the, let's say, this northern Latin America, which is an economy deeply integrated with the U.S. and has this the standard that in Spanish they call the maquiladora, which means makeup, and is the idea that you import a lot, you assemble, you send it back to the U.S. So these are, let's say, the different types of productive structures we have in Latin America. So we have countries in the north deeply integrated to the U.S., countries that they do have industrialized goods in their exports, but they are mostly assembling it. That means they cannot pay really high wages, and they cannot produce technology domestically significantly. So that still keeps these countries with significant vulnerabilities, still keeps these countries in the so-called periphery, depending on the dynamics of the center economies or core economies. And in the south, we still have economies that the exports are heavily weighted on commodities. But in the case of Mercosur, I'm putting separately from the mining and hydrocarbons, because five minutes. Okay. And then I put Mercosur separate because even though they're still heavy weighted on raw materials, they have, these countries, they have bigger domestic markets. In the case of Brazil, just as a figure, the external sector represents 5% of GDP. So the local economy is huge, it's the most important for development for the region. But what you export is what will give you the condition to generate a strong currency. So on the one hand, it's not relevant or that relevant in terms of growth, but it is what will guarantee that you won't suffer from foreign constraint. Because that is, maybe the biggest concern of CEPAL since ever, is that these economies, when they grow, they are constrained by foreign sector. So that means because of two main factors, I would say. The first is the differences between the income elasticity of imports and exports, which means when this economy grows, you tend to import in a higher pace than what the income you generate from exports. So that means you're going to grow until a point your imports will generate the balance of payment crisis. That would be one. And the other one is the dynamics of prices of the terms of trade. So given these whole figures of productive structures and demand structures, I try to put some of these numbers in perspective here. And here I picked, I made an average of the hydrocarbons exporters, which is Bolivia, which exports gas, Colombia, Ecuador, and Venezuela. And on the vertical axis, I put the GDP growth, the average annual growth on the periods I selected. And on the horizontal axis, I put current account results. And here I'm trying to show, I don't know if it's too small, but at the top right, it's the period of 2003-2008. So it's exactly the period of the pink tide or the period of the commodity boom. So that means for the hydrocarbons exporters, this period has allowed them to grow in a fast standard and without suffering foreign constraint. They also had a current account surplus. Similar result you'll see to the mining exporter countries. During the period of 2003-2008, they were growing a lot and they had also current account results. So that period allowed this group of countries to grow without foreign constraint. And that was also the case of Mercosur. Even though Mercosur was mostly growing, the growth of this region is not explained by the foreign sector. As I said, the foreign sector in Brazil accounts for 5% of GDP. This has allowed this country to grow without suffering from foreign constraints. And beyond that, during the period of the commodity boom, we also had a period of very high liquidity. So all these economies, they were also receiving huge flows of foreign direct investments and of capitals. So for this period, there was lots of growth and there was no foreign constraint. But that was not the case of Mexico, for example, or Central America. Because they have a different productive structure, the Texas trade shock that was clearly positive to the raw materials exported was not the case of Mexico. The event of China has not only made the commodity prices to go up, but also made industrialized goods to go down. And this has impacted a lot these maquiladoras countries, these countries that has assembly industries, negatively. So Mexico, even though they had a certain level of growth, they had around 2% of growth in the period, but they were not having current account results. That was not a problem because of financial flows, as I said. So they could finance this current account deficit because of amount of liquidity. And Central America even worse because of the productive structure they have. So I think the idea of showing these figures is that, okay, that is the Latin America we have today. It's different from a productive perspective, from a demand perspective. And this has allowed countries during the last 15 years to do more or less policies depending on the foreign constraint. And now I want that is my last topic, the third topic. I want to talk about what were the accomplishments during this period and what are the challenges to the future. And here, mostly because of South American countries, this figure is really interesting in my opinion because it shows that the pink tide took this period of time to increase significantly social spending. There is no doubt about that. Here is the increase of social spending in aggregate and in terms of GDP. So it's increased from 12% to 19% in the period. And then here from education, health, social security, and assistance. I just picked that I could show you many different data. Another important data is the minimum wage. But since I don't have aggregate four countries, I'm not showing it. But different countries, especially in South America, they had a policy of increasing minimum wage throughout the whole period. And this also helped, together with increased social spending, helped a very strong poverty reduction. These are figures for poverty reductions, both in percentage and in numbers of people. And also a significant reduction of the Gini index. So that means beyond the reduction in poverty, these countries, they could manage to use this period of commodity boom to reduce inequality significantly. It doesn't mean that Latin America now is Sweden. It doesn't mean now we're an equal society, but there was significant changes in terms of distribution, poverty reduction. And some would say that this also explains why social tensions has increased so much in the region, particularly my country. And then the question I would make is that, okay, so it's clear that during this time, Latin America accomplished to use, let's say, the commodity boom to reduce poverty, to reduce inequality. That's given, no discussion about that. But why these governments could not accomplish a structural change? We saw the figures there. These countries, they still depend a lot on raw materials. And there was also a speech from presidents that we want to change, we want to integrate more regionally. We want to diversify our economies, we want to industrialize. So why it was not enough? I think that's the question we should make at this time, and that is the challenge I would put to the future. And one could answer that the new classical economies, they're ready to say, now that the cycle is going down, they're ready to say that the model went wrong, now we need the neoliberalism to be back, free market, they're ready to say that. But we need to be ready to have a good narrative, to use evidence to say why it didn't work. One could say that the industrial policies were not enough, they were not strong enough, they were not effective enough, they were too little, and I would say it's quite true, there were very little industrial policy in the region. But if it is hard to make a structural change during a foreign constrained period, it's also hard to do structural change during a time of commodity boom. And that's because the market incentives to reproduce the structure you have, it's the market incentives, they're just really strong. And in my opinion, this enforces the argument that it's really hard to trust in natural development. It's really hard to trust that if you open your economies, if you allow free flows of capital, if you allow the market to operate its free hand, it's really hard to believe that this would allow you to diversify, to do what Korea did, to do what China did in terms of industrializing, to having a more complex productive structure. And that these are my two last graphs. And here I'm showing some returns on assets for the mining sector. And that's the hypothesis I'm bringing for you. So why we couldn't change the productive structure in the region? Because even though you have a strong speech on that, look at the differences between the return on asset for, let's say, a more knowledge-intensive sector, which is automotive, electronics, machinery, and the mining sector, for example. So the market stimulus, the price stimulus to reproduce investments on what you're already producing are really strong. It's really hard to have the adequate policy to make this sector flies. And this also return on assets on different on other different sectors. So what I'm saying is that for the future of development, there are many recommendations on what would be the best policy to use these income from commodities to industrialize. Argentina tried to create a tax on exports, so they would use that for innovation, right? But the political side of it was really tough against her. She almost was taken out of power because of this. I hope I made myself enough clear. I wanted to just briefly mention something interesting in Latin America. I hope I did. So thank you very much.
Why do we still have so many surprises in divergent narratives? So where is it coming from? Is it drawing on Professor McKenzie's thought? Is it development trying to sanitize something, saving itself instead of saving people? Or is it just lack of information? Is it shortcoming of local academia? Or what is behind all these diverging and gaps and surprises of development? Why we still need people to talk, to come here and talk and tell us that this is development and this is not development? And it might be very region specific, it might be like.
My first response would be in terms of when you're working on a region, on regions like Africa, it just is not reliable data. So there are obvious surprises as the narrative unfolds, etc. But the fundamental overarching reason is that we just don't have the data and information that people working on our regions.
I'll echo this question about data. I mean, I'm not trained formally as an economist, so I'm always trying to learn about how economists compile and use the data. And I've always been struck by so many good debates. Sanjay himself is very central in many of those debates about how do we measure various things and surprises. So I was very interested, for instance, in this global income consumption project. Suddenly, sub-Saharan Africa is more unequal than Latin America using household surveys rather than national income. I think part of it is that, but I think another reason might be, which is, in a sense, not about data, which is about what we know about the world, but the way in which the world actually unfolds, is I think that the two-step development, I remember when I was an undergraduate once, somebody said, how can it be the case that the entire global south, we call it the third world, developing world, the global south, how could it be the case that you'd expect homogeneity in most of the world? Right. So we can think of having the world that has certain global structures. Right? So we live in a capitalist world. But the way in which it unfolds is often through complex causal events. Lots of different factors are interacting. And some of it is sort of structural determinants, some of it has to do with social agency and how those unfold and how those interact over time. And really interesting. So one of the questions I was so interested in from the presentation, and in some sense the first and last, is with this commodity boom, which of these countries were able to take advantage of the commodity boom to industrialize, right? What Cardoso used to call it, having a dependent belt. So you're developing within relations of dependency, but you're able to slowly become industrialized. So which of those, you know, were able to or none of them? And one answer was that the money was too easy, you know, it was too hard to shift it towards something else. There might be other factors too, though, which have to do with social structure, so political institution, maybe much larger global dynamics.
Nobody's mentioned ideology, but clearly ideology is a big factor that drives this as well. I mean, people just, they perceive reality very differently. There's so many different contested narratives of what is success, what is failure, also what is priorities. I think ideology is also very important, I mean, how you approach a topic. So if I go in with a gender lens, I'm going to come up with very different types of, I mean, I presented some statistics that others didn't have in their presentations because I was looking at things like maternal mortality as a measure of development. So ideology, priorities, contested narratives, methodology. I do think, I mean, I would have talked about commodity boom had conflict not overshadowed the commodity boom narrative in the Arab region, right? So, you know, I could have had a whole talk about the question you just raised. But resource-based differences, like I don't even know how anybody could talk about a single development narrative given the different resource bases that countries come from. In each of these regions, we see some countries were more able to take advantage of the commodity boom than others. I mean, the Gulf states are just, you know, you go there and it's kind of breathtaking how much they've been able to do with the oil that they have. But it's also created massive inequality within the region and massive, you know, there's a lot of resentment against the people who were able to. But, you know, you also have to look at the colonial antecedents. So the way they carved the borders in the Middle East created these real elites who were able to control the commodity, which didn't happen in other parts of the world as much, right? At least not with this very narrow geographic focus. I mean, you can look at Nigeria where you had the same thing in a bigger geographical setting. So I guess that would be my answer to that.
Hey, Susan, do you have any microphone?
There's one on the table.
Oh, we've been all ignoring it.
I know.
That might be better.
Oh, you can't move it.
We'll fix it.
I would also go to the political side. I think looking at Latin America, during the 90s, we had the Washington Consensus was very strong in Latin America, I believe in other regions of the world as well. And the narrative there was, okay, after the industrialization period, that was too much. Now the state is too big, was the winning narrative. Now we need to reduce the state, we need to privatize, we need to open economies, and that will allow you to fly. You're going to get to the first world. And that didn't happen. In the end of the 90s, beginning of the 2000s, there was a big crisis. Argentina is the biggest example of it. It was after Brazil, 1999, big crisis in Brazil. 2001, Argentina. And this has allowed the narrative to change. And this allowed the left-wing governments to win in the region. And then now there's another crisis coming from the outside, and we have to be ready to have an evidence-based narrative to say, okay, this is what happened, this is what went wrong, this is what went okay. And I would say that as an economist, I think we have to be evidence-based, we have to have the good approach, we have to have the approach we're confident with. But we cannot forget that ideology will play a significant role on this. From the media, from universities, you know that you are in a heterodox school, you know, most economists in the U.S., you know what they're reading, what they're studying, and we have to play a bit more into the critics for the neoclassic economists to have a different approach and to use policy recommendation.
Thank you very much. So I'm
going to
ask the first round of questions. You have two questions, but you can refer to Professor McKenzie. So Akitoshi, she asked about China's FDI investment in infrastructure in Africa. Are there any alternative motives to it? And also there is a question, I guess, from online. People, so you said the role of WICS in Africa and the impact is on result. Can you discuss the pros and cons of China and South Africa FDI and how it differs from Western?
Yeah, okay, so Chinese ulterior motive, in fact, South African ulterior motive as well. I think in the presentation I spoke a little bit about Patrick Bond's ideas that South Africa in particular was operating as the sub-imperialist on the African continent. There is also a view that China too is after nothing but resources for her own development. So saying, African leaders seem to like, they want to do more business with China than they want to do with the West. There are several statements by African leaders that suggest that they're more comfortable doing business with China, that China treats Africans as more equals rather than kind of patronizing approach that the West has. The FDI, what Africa needs more than anything else is jobs. I mean, you go to places where, you know, 60-70% unemployment in the age group kind of 18 to 25. It's quite horrendous. And insofar as the FDI is in small, diverse projects, then the jobs are being created. What I haven't been able to do is actually track through the number of different projects and to see which FDI is going where. So for me, it's an unresolved question about where the FDI is actually going. What we read about are a lot of eye-catching Chinese mega projects, but the small projects we don't hear about so often. But from an African point of view, it would be the small projects that would be important. I don't have enough information to answer that second question.
Thank you. Maybe, Sanjay, do you have a comment on that with China?
I think most literature that I have is also quite unresolved. So two people I think have been working on this quite a bit. One is Deborah Brodingham at SAIS, who says, sort of echo some of what you began by saying, that there are fewer conditionalities attached to Chinese investment. There is a concern whether this is a neo-dependent relationship, right? Building infrastructure to extract resources. There's been a lot of attention on Chinese investments, particularly in agriculture and land grabs, because there's concerns over food security in China, and as you said, there's so much arable land, but that's creating potential conflicts in Africa. So I think that's one side of the story. So it's, and then the other one was actually by the sociologist C.K. Lee, who's been now working on questions of when, so it's more ethnographic work. So she's been studying particularly Chinese investments in Zambia, and says, you know, what's interesting is when many Chinese companies first come, they bring their own labor force. So you talked about employment, one of the things that many African governments, if you read, were assuming or hoping, is that all this Chinese investment would create employment. And then there may be also questions of technology transfer and reinvestment, right? Shared partnerships and so on and so forth. And I think it's an ongoing area. It's a terrific area to do research in because we don't actually have very firm answers. And obviously Africa being a huge continent, so it's going to vary across, and that's where I think a heterodox approach is very important because a lot will depend on the nature of the regimes and governments and class alliances in particular states that are able to wrest a greater share of Chinese investment for domestic purposes versus a purely extractive model.
Can I just add something that just occurred to me? In terms of actual experience, there's two types of experience. There's where Chinese behaved very, very badly in Zimbabwe and Zambia, and that there are cases in Angola where the government has set the parameters so tightly that the Chinese have no other choice but to comply. So in large part, I think it depends on the government to set parameters within which the Chinese operate. If you leave it wide open, then you get a Zimbabwe, you get a Zambia.
Can I make a comment?
Yes.
I would comment on China and BRICS. I think from Latin America, I see basically two types of approaches coming. One would say, okay, China is the new hegemon. It will overcome the US hegemony, something like the transition from UK to US hegemony. Now we'll face US, China, and that will be the new hegemon and the new leader. Others would say that now we will have a new century, a new poor economies. Before we had US, of course US together with Europe and Japan, but now we would have China together, or we would have these two players disputing influence, disputing investments, disputing markets. And that would be the new world. We won't have one hegemon, but we would have two. And that would be the new world. That's what I've been seeing coming from Latin America. What would be China? And for the BRICS, I honestly, I don't like the idea of looking at the BRICS as new sub-imperialism. I believe I would see it, and that's a lot coming from a Brazilian perspective. BRICS, first, it's very different countries. What the role of China in the world economy is different from Brazil, different from China, South Africa. And as I understand the BRICS, it's much more one of the different elements that are happening today in the world to question the international architecture that was built after the war. There is, after Bretton Woods, there was the World Bank, the IMF, the United Nations. I mean, there was a set of, there was an international architecture that was built at this time, and what these countries are saying, okay, this world from 45 has changed today. There are new players, new leaders. I wouldn't say they're new superimperialists, but these countries have been asking for a bigger role in this architecture. And the BRICS association with the BRICS bank and with the forums, it's much more, in my understanding, it's much more a way on how to create a more multilateral way of participating in the world than trying to behave as a superimperialist in the region. And particularly from Brazil, we have always treated every country from the region on the same level. We never have asymmetric relations with any countries. So we see the BRICS as an instrument to make the world more multilateral, more multidimensional, and not only led by one or several countries.
I want to just open another broad question. We have another related question to that as well, which is the role of like political activism in these areas, and like how political activists in each of these areas can affect what's going on with development actually. And there is this question for Sanjay, which is, since the Indian labor force is largely internal, how do the right movement activists advocate to improve workers' rights?
So the rights movement in India actually, starting in the late 70s, early 80s, is a response to, actually, this is my interpretation, two weaknesses in the traditional labor movement. So one is the size of what we would call the proletariat was extremely tiny in India, right? So maybe 10 to 20 million workers in the formal economic sector were industrial workers. They were very militant early 1980s. There was a very important upstart union in Bombay, in the textile mills. 250,000 workers went on strike. But the regime very quickly repressed it. So one aspect of why labor has not been the sort of historic protagonist of rights-based development in India is because it's small. You know, it's actually very tiny. But a second aspect is because these unions were divided along partisan lines, but the other thing is that they were mostly concerned with their own workers, as many unions are, right? They want to protect their workers' interests, whether their wages, working conditions, pensions, so on and so forth. The unions themselves did very little for workers in other sectors. So the rights movement was really an attempt to expand social entitlement to the vast majority of the Indian labor force that had no representation and that the unions themselves were not representing. And India is an extreme case, but I think you see very similar things. I mean, Brazil is a good example where, so the PT and the workers' movement is very important in the early 1980s, but you still have a rights-based constitutional movement that leads to the 88 constitution. Now, why is that? It's because the language of constitutionalism is a language of citizenship, of equal social rights. In Brazil and in South Africa, you have a similar thing. You have a constitution which grants certain social rights. So again, the unions in South Africa are very important. But they were seen in all of these countries as insufficient. India's extreme case. So I think that's part of it. Now, I think it's definitely still the case. If you have a traditional labor movement that's allied to the rights movements, you're going to get a more progressive outcome. And I think that's why it was more progressive in Brazil than India. South Africa is a more peculiar case. I don't fully understand because you had a very militant labor movement, you had a very progressive constitution, but somehow they haven't kind of coalesced. And so you can see different scenarios. And again, I think the sort of complex causal change that explain why you get this sort of diversity.
Thank you.
So
Jennifer?
Obviously, in the context of MENA, the big question is the Arab uprisings, and there's been a huge outpouring of scholarship that's looked at this, and I sort of feel like there's been a roller coaster effect when it comes to analysis of the Arab uprising. In the beginning, there was a euphoria that this was the Arab Spring and everybody was happy, and you know that these regimes that had been in place for many years, many of them had finally fallen. Then we kind of hit a real low point where there was just despair that there wasn't a lot of political change. And I think we're sort of, you know, there's a recent, some political scientists have just come out with a study where they basically say, look, we shouldn't be despairing. This Arab uprising was a huge turning point, and you really have to think about that there's gonna be a reaction and that it takes time to work these things out. So I think there's been, the scholars have been on sort of a roller coaster, just like the people in the region have been on a roller coaster. I mean, aside from the Arab uprising, obviously the other really important question is the rise of political Islam. And as somebody who's been going to the region, and particularly to the Palestinian territories, since the late 1980s, where most of my colleagues were members of the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine and other more socialist and Marxist-oriented organizations, those groups have almost disappeared from the discourse. And what's replaced them is political Islam. And so really, you see the Muslims taking on this social justice message that was originally much more the left. And this, of course, creates real challenges for progressives, because you see that around economic issues, the Islamists are often pushing for very progressive ideas, but then in other areas, on social norms, they have a much more conservative message. So it's definitely created some real challenges. I'm not an expert on workers' rights, but there have been a series of strikes, and even in the aftermath of the Arab uprisings, there's still been movement around labor. And I'm more familiar with women's groups, and there have been some really interesting emerging, like in Egypt after the Arab uprising, there was massive push to address the problem of sexual harassment, because sexual harassment was definitely one of the factors that really was a negative in the Arab uprisings. And so there's been huge progress made. So Cairo University has now passed very strong sexual harassment rules. There have been a series of young entrepreneurs who've come up with apps to like trace, you know, for women to report if they're being sexually harassed. So there's been some interesting pockets of changes that you might not think of as being economically so relevant, but that were definitely an outpouring after the Arab uprising.
Insofar as I understand the question, I'm dealing with South Africa first. South Africa has this long tradition of activism. So the unions, the women's groups, the environmentalists have quite a strong presence. And government, the ANC ruling party, it really has to listen to these various groups. That's counterbalanced by a situation like Angola, where dissent is usually followed by a prison, by imprisonment. So there's no background of any kind of dissent there. And I think the latest case in Angola is where they've just rounded up some activists, six or so of them, and then placed them in jail. And it's the activist network outside of the country that you have to rely on to bring public attention to it, etc. And Ethiopia has the same kind of concerns. I think where activists have been most successful is in the case of the tax justice network across the African continent. It's a trans-African network. And they have been relatively successful at raising people's awareness to do with things like transfer pricing by the big companies, income tax evasion, etc., etc. So, you know, in a sense, it's very difficult to talk about one Africa. The various countries are different. And there are some various kind of different outcomes.
Thank you.
Okay, I will talk only about Brazil on that. I'm not very comfortable talking on Latin America about this, but what I could say is that Brazil had we had a very violent dictatorship from 1964 till 85. That's how Cold War got to us. And at the end of the dictatorship, like end of 70s, beginning of 80s, is when working movements, they started to organize themselves. And in 1988 is when we have the constitution made. And as we're saying, the constitution guarantees social rights and working rights. During the neoliberal period, that these rights, they were being questioned. The idea, okay, we have too rigid labor markets, we have to make them more flexible. That was the agenda. When the Workers' Party wins the election, that agenda goes out of the government agenda. So that means the workers in Brazil, they have important rights in terms of minimum wage, in terms of vacation, in terms of paid leave. So when we have a relatively strong protection for workers. And what is interesting to mention is that together with keeping these rights going on in this period, we could accomplish also having an increase in social spending. And these together allowed the helps to explain why the economy was growing. In my presentation, I said that the external sector explains, it represents 5% of GDP. So that means the growth we had in this period was mostly related to an increase in social spending, so an increase in lower income, in increasing lower income. So that means that allowed people to spend more money. That's the typical Keynesian multiplier was working pretty well, and the Keletskian accelerator effect was working. That means the more poor you are, the more income you have, the more you spend. So this effect was quite clear during this period. And so we had growth without having a lower labor rights. And we also have increasing labor formalization, because that's another argument we often listen from neoclassical economists, that we have too much informality because there's too much regulation. And in our case, we kept a regulation on labor markets, and still we had growth. We had increasing informalization because of enforcement policy. So I think that these are comments I would make.
Thank you very much. I know that this is not the best way of getting questions, just like one speaker, like I'm reading questions, but because of the way that we are live streaming, we have to like go through this way. So I'm going to ask two very general questions from the audience. I'm going to read it, but I wanted to go around the table because we only have 5 minutes, but I wanted to like be like as final comments and just. Over the years, some countries have been consistently under the influence recommended by orthodoxy, while others have followed various various alternatives. Has these experiments provided enough evidence to compare and contrast what works and what doesn't? And in an area of degrading global ecology, increasing movement of people, and growing informal labor market, what is development under these conditions?
I'm going to focus on the first rather than the second. I think one of the things I didn't get to say before is also the discourse around the social contract is really important, and I think in the Middle East region there's been an ongoing discourse around the government's need to provide jobs and to also provide basic food and things like this. And I think comparing what are sort of seen as the requirements of the government in terms of delivering to the people is a really interesting comparison. I think. In the context of the Arab region, I think what's more interesting is the sort of forced move to orthodoxy that countries such as Iraq was demanded of Iraq, right? After the devastation that was imposed on them, a bunch of US economists were airlifted into the green zone and were basically put there to set up the neoliberal agenda for Iraq. And this is actually written about in a Journal of Economic Perspectives. I mean, these guys were open about this. The way they talked about it. And they also were open about their frustration with the fact that Iraqis said, we want the government to supply jobs. So this real, you can really see that disconnect between the discourse of neoliberalism and the expectations of the indigenous social contract coming together in Iraq in these very clashing ways. And luckily, international law didn't allow all of the things that the US wanted to impose. So I think that provides a really interesting case study for thinking about this. But more generally, this sort of discourse of what people expect is then reflected in some of the what the narrative that people have. I just want to make one more point that I didn't get to make, and this also gets at the comparison issue. I think we have huge data deficits, which you guys talked about, but we also have knowledge overload. So it's like this weird combination of having no data, but having just being bombarded with case studies. And as you were speaking, I was thinking about how many of us know that Latin America was consistently holding on with to minimum wage laws when we have this discourse in the US about minimum wage laws are terrible, and yet we have all these case studies that we could look at in Latin America and see that minimum wage laws were doing really well, where, you know, that growth was able to happen. So I think there's both data deficits and knowledge overload, and that there are some really exciting comparative work that, that young scholars could be engaged in, where they pick up some of these interesting patterns around the way different societies have pushed for certain types of progressive agendas, and then compare them maybe with other cases. And some of this can be just looking at countries at the same time period. In the case of Iraq, when you have a very sudden shift, you can look at the sort of before and after. But there's different ways that those comparisons can happen.
Okay, I will, since I'm in a non-traditional school, I'll take the freedom to be radical. Radical. And the second question is understood. Is, okay, there are orthodoxy and there is alternative approaches. What that worked? And I would say that the idea that we have in most universities, that the idea of the policymaker, I would say that does not exist. There is no such a thing as a policymaker. That does not exist. It's not possible that the guy that won the election will sit there, will pick a pen, and will say, this is the policy, you know? It's not like this. Even if you have the best idea, the best approach, you have a society that you have to convince people that they will accept. And maybe if you have a lot of power, or violent power, whatever, maybe you can impose your plan, but even if you have the best idea, the best diagnosis, you have to convince guys in Congress, you have to convince, and power is not something abstract. Politics and power is something very concrete in the sense that you have to convince 6 big banks that they rule the economy somehow. And you have to convince these guys from these important industries. And so there is no such a thing as a policymaker. In my opinion, it's impossible to answer this works, this doesn't work. Because even if you would know this answer, politics play the main role on that. And I can give an example of Brazil on that. The first Lula government, he could not change. Some people say that was his decision. We don't know. But the fact is that he could not change fiscal policy and monetary policy. He could not. The president of the central bank was a guy that was recommended by financial sector. And I believe the same happens in the US. Who has the treasury here? Is the guy that Obama wants, or is the guy that some bankers want? So I think I would say that it's very complex that you dealing with societies and with policy recommendation. I think in the university we have to do the empirical analysis, theoretical analysis. We have to have the best diagnosis as possible, but it's really hard to say what works and what doesn't work, because in practice you can never do what you wanted in the book. I think that was too confusing.
That's a really hard question. So I just think of the two cases that I talked about. And I think what's really striking is they've been most successful, and this is predictable to say, but I think it's still worth stating. They've been most successful when they have pursued hybrid policy frameworks that take advantage of their own institutional strengths and are able to sort of mobilize support for those. So I think that's one. And I think two, the hybridity sometimes takes on aspects that we normally were critical about. So, you know, China has its greatest reduction in poverty in the 1980s when it implements a household responsibility system, which creates market-like incentives for small rural families to invest. And you see a massive increase in agricultural production and a massive decrease in rural poverty. And then the brigades become the models for these township and village enterprises, which is where rural industrialization begins. Now, that model then, of course, becomes different and has different consequences 15 years later. So this sort of, I think one thing is it's about adaptability and flexibility and experimentation is very important to think about in policy terms. But also it's very difficult because there's inertia, there's ossification, there are vested interests, and sometimes that can make it hard to do that. So I think it's sort of a question of hybridity, institutionally and policy-wise, that seems to matter. I get a sense that you know what policies don't work. You know that implementing, you know, structural adjustment mercilessly doesn't work. Leite lost decades. But it's much harder to think about what works. There's no, you know, so if you look at the developmental state literature in the 50s, 60s, 70s, you know, there's a model of the developmental state. But when you actually look under the hood, there's some commonalities, but there's different policies, you know. You can support industrialists sometimes with tax credits, sometimes with direct spending, sometimes. And so those instrumentalities can differ. So I think that, and that makes sense because just think about the panel, such diversity across these places. Why would you assume that there would be a single model that consistently would achieve the goals of sort of progressive egalitarian development that you might strive for?
I can't think of any country on the African continent that's pursued anything but a kind of neoliberal path. So the only one I can think of is Zimbabwe, who pursued their own kind of land reform type policies, and we all know what's happened to Zimbabwe. In terms of the question on development, I go back to Sears and Sen. I think if we're asking ourselves what is development, I think is obviously about right. Well, I say obviously, but it's about rights. And the more rights that the human being has, the more developed, I would say, his society. So I think a look back at the literature would help significantly. I think also anything that deepens dependency is a step backwards. But I would definitely kind of champion the names of Sears and Sen as kind of defining development.
Thank you very much. Thank you everyone for these very interesting talks. I apologize if we were not be able to have your voice here, but so I propose to like have your conversation in our coffee break and also in the reception that we have after the second panel. Thank you very much, everyone.